Number 222. Let's stand together. Be seated. Number 834. I guess move to the centers of the aisles. Make some room for our guest. I think if someone walked in here tonight, they would be convinced that we really believe what we're singing. Number 834.
Pray.
Number one.
Each day I'll do.
Number 820. Y'all are singing well. 820.
I'm
Number 203.
Man of sorrow.
Two hundred forty-three. See if those altos can grab another gear.
Soul.
296. Number 757.
Seated. Number 799. We done?
No.
Oh. Good. Not the Price is Right, but come on down. I tell you what, if we would, we'll sing 799. Let's go ahead and stand again. That'll give you an opportunity to kind of move up and get close, if you don't mind. We'll go ahead and fill some of these pews up on the front for sure. We'll give you an opportunity to kind of move around. 799.
Sure.
that'll keep you awake like it does me. You may be seated. Brother Clark, are we taking a minute or two break, and we'll gather back in and be a little bit closer together, a little closer to the front. You're dismissed for a couple minutes.
Brother Gary,
down here. Where is it at in the list of things? The song of prayer, Lord's Supper, okay. And then D-Berry.
It is it's past time for us to get started. We are thrilled, delighted to see this wonderful crowd. It's Sunday evening, and we have a great number who are here already. Sometimes they don't arrive till Monday or Tuesday, and I think our crowd's just going to be getting larger and larger. We get off to a rousing start this morning with tremendous presentations of the Word of God by Brother David Sain, who encouraged us greatly. And then Brother Grider preached a powerful sermon on God's definition of marriage that convicted us greatly. And we appreciate so much the way in which this lectureship has gotten started. We do want to announce about some folks who have been ill so that you can rest your mind a little bit during the worship service and also know about them for the prayer that's upcoming. Brother Stephen Sutton will be leading our singing, and what a great job he does leading our singing. And then Brother Don Gary, who graduated in 2012, now preaches in Ames, Oklahoma, is going to be leading us in our prayer. Some of you know that Adam Evans's daughter, Emma, had a bout with malaria. The good news is that she is somewhat better, but still needs our prayers as we continue to keep her in mind. Also, Brett Rutherford, you know, has been mentioned, and the first treatment that he received from what I just learned tonight, did such an effective job that they are very, very, very optimistic. It shrunk the tumors that had been located so much that they're having difficulty seeing them like they once did. And so we're going to keep on praying for Brett Rutherford. Many of you have asked about my mother, and certainly I appreciate that. She went to the emergency room this morning. A fluid had been building up for a few days, and then her blood pressure this morning at the emergency room was 252 over 115, and they did some tests all day, got her blood pressure down in the high ones instead of the mid twos, and she'll have to come back and get some more work done. She'll go to the doctor in a couple of days, but the good news is they didn't find any heart attack evidence. No problem with her kidneys, and they feel optimistic that This was an early warning sign of congestive heart failure, but not anything that would be fatal at this point if she's able to make some changes and able to get some relief that way. So please keep my mother, Sherry Clark, in your prayers, and appreciate those of you who've already asked about her. I'll have more to say at the end of the service about this, but I do want you to know that the bookstore will be open in the building next door for only 30 minutes after services tonight, and also for 30 minutes only after services tonight, you can buy your tickets to the Curtis A. Cates tribute dinner, which is going to be tomorrow at 4:15 p.m. It's 4:15 p.m. One thing that Sister Cates requested as we plan the dinner is that we keep the time limit to where everyone can come at 6:30 and enjoy the singing, and we're going to honor that. And so that dinner will begin at 4:15 tomorrow, and it will be a way of celebrating the life of Curtis A. Cates. We're going to be very upbeat and positive about the things. It's not going to be any kind of a somber thing. We miss him greatly, but we're rejoicing, and we will have a spirit of joy tomorrow evening as we remember Brother Cates. And I'm so excited that the contributions that you made, some of you made to the book called Catesisms, Memories of Curtis A. Cates Sr., Brother Sane just handed me this. He said that he gave Sister Cates her copy, and she already has one. But this contains a number of memories from students of Brother Cates, co-workers, members of congregations where Brother Cates had been and taught. And the exciting thing about this is that the family has requested that proceeds from the sale of this book will benefit the faculty fund here at the Memphis School of Preaching for maintaining and hiring teachers of the future and being able to compensate them adequately for their work. As certainly, as you know, they make many sacrifices, and this book will be available for $5, and those proceeds will go to the faculty fund, and we'll tell you more about that. At the end, I want to tell you more about a booklet by Brother Elkins, but I want to save that for the end so that you'll know immediately what to do after we're dismissed if you'd like to have a copy. So let's go ahead and enter into our worship service tonight. Again, we'll be led in singing by Brother Sutton, led in prayer by Brother Gary, and then at the appropriate time, I will introduce our speaker for this evening's message.
Please go ahead and mark number 800. 800, that'll be the song of invitation tonight, following Brother DeBerry's sermon, number 800. Let's stand and sing number 290.
I love my King, the Lord, the house of my Lord, the church of the Redeemer, saved with his own precious blood. I love my church, O God, her walls before his hand, near as he has.
Please bow with me. Our most righteous and holy God, thou art almighty, kind, and just, from whom comes every blessed word. Father, we thank thee for this opportunity we have to gather in thy name. We thank thee, Father, for the fellowship we have in thy Son. Father, we thank thee for this wonderful opportunity to sing thy praise, to learn from thy word. Father, this time also we come before thee, thanking thee for the good measure of health that we have, and remembering those who are unable to do so. Father, we pray that you'll be with the Evans family and the struggles of Adam's daughter. Father, we pray that you'll be with them that minister to her. Father, we pray that you'll be with Brother Rutherford and the bout that he's struggling with physically. Father, we also want to remember Brother Clark's mother, Sherry Clark. We're thankful for the good news we've had in light of recent events. We pray that you'll be with her as she recovers. Father, especially at this time, we thank thee for thy wonderful name, to know that you are our God and we are your people. And it's in your Son's blessed name that we pray. Amen.
If you do not have the opportunity to partake of the Lord's Supper this morning, we're glad to provide that for you. We'll sing number 330. And then as the men come down the aisles, if you'll let them know by raising your hand, they'll be glad to serve you. 330.
On this Lord's Day, we assemble round the table of the Lord. Happy hearts are made to tremble when we hear His blessed word. Thanks to God for such a Savior.
As was mentioned, if you haven't had an opportunity to partake in the Lord's Supper, raise your hand as we come by and we'll be glad to serve you. Let's go to God in prayer. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, hallowed be thy name. Father, we thank you for this opportunity we have this evening to partake in this communion, this memorial of Christ and his suffering on our behalf. And pray now as we partake of this bread, as it represents Christ's body, that we will do so in a well-pleasing manner in thy sight. And all this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Our Father, we thank thee for this cup. We thank thee for thy Son and for thy love. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Separate and apart from the Lord's Supper, we are also commanded upon the first day of the week to lay by in store. Let's pray. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all the many blessings of this life, both spiritual and material. Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we have today to give back a portion of those blessings. We pray that we will do so as we've been prospered. We'll do so with a cheerful heart. It's in Jesus' name that we pray.
Amen. Amen.
I'm hoping that tonight we can get Brother DeBerry to come out of his shell and just say what he thinks. Actually, the thing I appreciate about Brother DeBerry is that he doesn't say what he thinks. He says what God said. And he preaches that with fervor and with enthusiasm. And we are grateful to God for the work that he does. There are so many things about him that I could tell you. And of course, most of you know that he is a state congressman. And certainly he has been involved in a number of things that have blessed a lot of people. But I don't think there's anything I could tell you about him that is more significant than the fact that he has been a gospel preacher for decades. And he continues to promote the gospel of Christ wherever he goes. He has resisted the pressure of some to not speak out, and he still speaks out for what's right. And so when Brother Mosier and Brother Grider and I met about the lectureship and its topics, and we thought about this kingdom of God is still standing, we knew we needed someone that could stand and with strength and conviction and power convey that message to their hearers. And certainly, I don't think that anyone better could have been selected than Brother John DeBerry. I'm grateful that he is here. And we're going to be privileged to hear him sing, excuse me, preach. You didn't know that, did you? You could probably do that too, couldn't you? I'm sure you could. Brother Sutton, come up and lead us in one song. And after this song, Brother John DeBerry will step forward and preach the gospel to us. Still standing, but not standing still. The kingdom of God is still standing.
585, let's stand. 585.
Soldiers of Christ, arise and lift your armor on. Strong in the strength of the Lord, God is alive. Strong in the strength of the Lord, God is alive.
When you think about man and who he is and how he was created and how he's wired, so to speak, there seems to be a consistent flaw about man. You know, God made man. He created us. The Bible tells me that he formed man from the dust of the earth and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So man is not something that simply crawled from the primordial ooze and developed some legs and some arms and decided to be a man the way the evolutionists claim he was. But man is a product of intelligent design. We know that God created us. It was God who decided to make someone to love. He created a garden, planted a garden east of Eden called the Garden of Pleasantness, and there he placed man. He eventually created the woman from his side of man, took a rib and created woman and placed her at his side inside of that garden. So we understand something about man because we read the Bible. We don't have to go to the zoo looking for relatives, and we don't have to go to the library searching for man's hypothesis. I can go to the Bible, and the Bible tells me exactly who I am and where I came from. But there's one thing I know about man, that man has failed to comprehend his limitations and his finite abilities. Man, for some reason, fails to comprehend God's limitless abilities and that God is infinite in his power, his authority, and in his abilities. Because man fails to understand this, he oftentimes, because of his own arrogance and because of his own inability to listen and learn and to read God's word and accept God at his word, man will plan those things which he cannot sustain. He will build those things which will be eventually dismantled. And God has to constantly tell us about our limitations and tell us that we have a expiration date. I know that it is appointed unto man once to die, and after death the judgment, because God tells me. So therefore, I know I have an expiration date. I have a moment in time that God knows, and I don't know and don't really want to know, when I'm going to breathe my last breath, and I'm going to see my last sunrise. I'm going to see my wife and children and grandchildren, and maybe if I live, great-grandchildren, and I can leave this world as God has commanded me to. So therefore, you say, Brother DeBerry, what's the relevance of this when you start talking about the kingdom of God still standing? This persistent and constant misunderstanding of his own abilities often causes man to appropriate to himself that which can only be given to God. Man will seek to have and contain and use authorities that do not belong to him. Solomon penned it very well a long time ago when Solomon said this about mankind's dispensation, about what mankind has to learn. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verses 1, Solomon said, to everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under heaven. And therefore, Solomon is saying very clearly that man must grasp the fact that what he conceives, he builds, he assembles, whatever he sets forth, it all has an expiration date, a time of dismantling, a date of termination, a time to be destroyed. Every earthly pursuit, every earthly inclination will one day end. Man alone has no ability to sustain that which only God can perpetuate. So therefore, that being said, when we talk about the kingdom of God still standing, when we talk about the kingdom of God still powerful, still influential, when we talk about the kingdom of God still having ability to change the minds of men and women in the world where there is so much evil to distract them, I tell people all the time, Satan doesn't have to destroy you. All Satan has to do is distract you. And with all of the distractions that are there that are false and corrosive and perverted, all those things that can turn us against God, the kingdom of God still stands. Man must understand that he cannot destroy God's kingdom. So when we go to the word of God, we understand that everything pertaining to man has a season. The word season denotes a fixed allocation of time. Solomon, in his wisdom, Solomon, who is often called the laboratory of human experience, when he wrote his book, Solomon basically has experienced everything that man can experience. God lets us know there will never be anybody richer than Solomon, more powerful than Solomon. Solomon had everything. He is a laboratory of how humans respond to excess. So when Solomon looks at everything that God has given him and everything that he has accomplished and all that he has built and planted and acquired over a lifetime, Solomon has to look at it and clearly say from a point of wisdom, vanity of vanity, says the preacher, all is vanity. Man must understand those things that he seeks to build, those things that he seeks to construct, those things which he seeks to ordain and set up, all of them will at some point fall because they have a certain allocation of time. But now I want you to understand something else. Solomon also had the wisdom to understand that God is infinite in his wisdom, infinite in knowledge, infinite in power, that the omnipresence of God puts him everywhere to do everything as his will and his purpose dictates. So Solomon concluded the thought with an infinite statement of fact. This is the fact that Solomon placed before the people in this pearl of wisdom that we call Ecclesiastes in chapter 3 and verses 14. Solomon said, I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall stand forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it, and God doeth it, that man should fear before him. Solomon said, I'm wise enough and got enough sense to see that what I build will be destroyed, but what God builds cannot be destroyed. It is God who decided to build this kingdom, to construct this kingdom. It was God who put it in his purpose, and man should stand in awe, therefore, of all that God has done and ordained forever. Now, when we look at our subject tonight, of course, you know, we've got to go to the book of Daniel. When we think about the kingdom that will stand forever, because the book of Daniel, as we read and study that book, and I'm sure as the professors and teachers and instructors here at this wonderful school has already said to the students that many times the book of Daniel has been one of the most maligned and one of the most talked about and energetically objected to documents within the scriptures. Because there are those who clumsily and with confusion try to attribute it to everybody but Daniel. They're trying to say it is legends, it's a bunch of stories, it is written by anonymous Maccabean authors. They try to say that Daniel was not an inspired prophet. They'll try to tell you everything they can to do everything possible to discredit the book of Daniel. But Daniel is a book that tells us those things that God planned before the foundation of the world. And the Dead Sea Scrolls, on their discovery, mostly, for the most part, put to rest all of those disagreements about the divine inspiration of the book of Daniel. When I mentioned earlier that man was created by God, there is a reason why there must be a kingdom. There is a reason why the Lord must set up this institution. Because man transgressed God's law. Man violated God's justice, and God had to create redemptive religion so that man could be bought back, redeemed, reconciled, atoned, and put back in the right position with his God. When the Bible lets me know in the first messianic prophecy, in the book of Genesis, the chapter is 3, and the verse is 15, God said, after man had sinned, after man had broken his heart and done the one thing that God had told him not to do and taken the one thing that God had held from him. God said, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, as he spoke to the devil, and the woman between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. As Moses, in retrospect, is writing here, what Moses wants us to know is that God had a plan. Even though man sinned, God knew before man sinned. Before there was sin, there was already a Savior. I tell people all the time that God is never surprised. God is never blindsided. God has never said, oh, I didn't see that coming. God has never looked up and been surprised about anything. Has it ever occurred to you, as I told you once before, that nothing has ever occurred to God? God is omnipotent, and God knows everything. So therefore, God had a plan. As the Apostle Paul said to our brethren that worship in Ephesus, in that ancient Greek city. The Bible says, as Paul wrote to them in chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, Paul said, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he has chosen in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. God laid therefore the plans. God decided to save man. God decided to send a savior. God decided to have a family. God decided to have a law, to build a kingdom, to have a monarch over it who would be Christ, who would say later that I have all power in heaven and in earth. In the book of 1 John, the chapter is 2, the verses 15 and verses 16. I hear John, as he is wrote, inspired by the Holy Ghost, he said, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, John said, the love of the Father is not in him. John wanted us to realize this, for all that is in the world is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, and not of the Father. This is not of the Father, but of the world. But notice what he said about the world. And we know that Jesus was planned, the church was planned, the kingdom was planned, man's salvation was planned before the foundation of the world. He said to us very clearly, and the world passeth away, and the lust that thereof, but he that doeth the will of the Father, he that doeth his will abide forever. Basically, what the Lord wants us to remember and keep in mind is that God always has a divine plan. There has always been a divine plan. Now, when we think about the book of Daniel and knowing that God does nothing arbitrarily, the book of Daniel makes a powerful presentation of God's foreknowledge of the rise and the fall of these kingdoms that are mentioned in that great book. God knows these kingdoms are going to come, that they're going to rise, that they're going to flourish, that they're going to become wealthy, that they're going to become militarily powerful and politically astute. But the Lord also wants us to know that each of these kingdoms, each of these subsequent kingdoms, they shall rise, they shall have their moment of glory, and they shall pass away. And what the Lord wants us to know is there will be a kingdom established by him. After man has made his best efforts to build eternal kingdoms, after man has made his best efforts to build that which never will be dismantled, that he will fail and God will succeed. Notice what the prophet Isaiah wrote in the book of Isaiah. The chapter is 46. And I want you to notice with me verses 9 and verses 10. Isaiah wrote, remember the former things of old, for I am God, speaking God there, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me. As he declared in verses 10, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times, the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. In essence, God says, I'll tell you things before they happen, because I am God. I will ordain those things that happen, because I am God. And the book of Daniel proclaims that God is the only eternal sovereign. Now, this book was written somewhere between 605 and 536 B.C. And within this period, we become very acquainted with Daniel, who is in Babylonian captivity. We know that Daniel was one like many of the children of Israel who are now a captive in a foreign land. This book bears his name. He is the central character in this book. And so the purpose and the message of the book of Daniel is very simple, that God is going to build a kingdom. Now, I want you to notice, when you put in your notes Daniel chapter 1, verses 1 and verses 2, the children of Israel were to know, and we are to understand, that God delivered them. The children of Israel, Judah, on many occasions broke the heart of God with disobedience. Even in the days of the judges, there was a continual digression from the word of God and the ways of God. I remember when I was in school, they called it sin, servitude, sorrow, salvation, relapse, retribution, repentance, rescue. They would sin. God would put them in servitude. They would scream out for God to save them, and God would send a Savior to bring them out of their captivity. Well, they are in the hands of Nebuchadnezzar, not because God is not powerful, or not because God does not keep his word, or not because God's covenant is not sure, or not because God doesn't have the power to release them and save them and reconcile them, but because of their own sin. God delivered them there because of their own sin. So therefore, the purpose of the writings of Daniel and the book of Daniel is to give them a moment of light and a moment of understanding for God to say, I am still your God. There is still a covenant. The covenant I made with your fathers, there is still a covenant that I'm going to bring salvation. There is still a promise that I'm going to build a kingdom. And Daniel was to write this and send this glimmer of hope to the people of God. So there is a dream. He's a prophet for the right time. He's a man of his time. And I want you to realize that the king has a dream. And the king's dream bothers him to the point that the king cannot sleep, the king cannot rest, and the king wants some answers to what's going on. He sees this image. He has this dream. And the Bible lets me know in the book of Daniel chapter 2 that he calls for the so-called wise men of Babylon. Now, all these jokers have been making a living for a long time being the wise men of Babylon. They've been strutting and styling and smiling and profiling around the king for quite some time, making a living, claiming that they have some type of power and magical abilities and they can interpret dreams. So the king has a dream, and it troubles him so. So now he calls on them to produce all of those things which they have been claiming for years that they can do. They have to all of a sudden produce, because at that time, Daniel was completing his training, and the king has this dream, and he calls for all those foretellers. I want you to realize that they came in their usual fashion. And I can see them bringing the incense and doing all their little signs and putting on their little show. And the king says, I had a dream. They say, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will show you the interpretation of the dream. So, you know, the king is smart enough to know that if he tells him the dream, if he remembers the dream, he say, I don't remember it, but I guess we can decide whether he remembered it or he was just testing them. But he says, I'm not going to tell you. I'm not telling you anything. And as a matter of fact, the king said, you better tell me what I dreamed. You better give me the interpretation of it. I'm going to have y'all chopped up and fed to the dogs. Now, the king is real serious about this thing. At this point, the king wants them to produce what they've been making a living from all of this time. So he calls the magicians and the astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans and the soothsayers. He calls all of these people together and he tells them, you need to tell me what I dream. When they couldn't tell him what he dreamed, he got Arioch and he said, you go find all the wise men of Babylon and you destroy and you kill every one of the so-called wise men of Babylon. Now that's a far-reaching decree. Because there are a whole lot of so-called wise men in Babylon, a bunch of magicians and soothsayers and all types of Chaldeans and various arts and dark arts and magic and enchantments, which they did for a living, reading folks' palms and tea leaves and smoking bumps on folks' heads in order to make money. This is the kind of thing that they did. And because they did this, the king said, you need to produce. You see, here's the deal. God will always expose wrong. God will always expose the wrongdoer. God will always expose false doctrine. God will always expose false ways. And just as Nebuchadnezzar calls in these fake wise men on that day and say, y'all need to tell me what I dream, I'm reminded of what happened back in Egypt a long time ago. You remember when Moses stood before Pharaoh and Moses said, God told me to tell you to let my people go. Pharaoh said, ain't gonna do it. I will not release them. And because Pharaoh made the statement that he would not respect Moses' God, who is God that I should obey him? Don't you realize that each of those plagues was exposing a religious system where some religious big shots been walking around with incense and making a living around the Pharaoh? Somebody led the enchantments when they worshiped the Nile. God turned it to blood. Somebody had the enchantments where they worshiped the sun. God reached down and flipped the switch and turned it off. Somebody did the enchantments when they worshiped the reptiles and the winged asp, the wasp and the locust and the fields and the cows and their own purity and cleanliness. God, in each of those 10 plagues, destroyed their religious system. God lets me know that if I didn't build it, if I didn't plant it, if I didn't ordain it, if I didn't set it, if I didn't give it, if I didn't send it, it will be rooted up. God roots up false doctrine. And you keep that in mind as we talk about the kingdom of heaven still standing. Well, each of us know that the wise men of Babylon were unable. But when it got around to Daniel, and Daniel being one of the wise men of Babylon, Daniel said, don't be hasty with this decree. I will go before the king. I will not only give him the interpretation, but I will tell him what he dreamed. And when Daniel got before the king, he says, thou, O king, you sawest, and behold, a great image, whose brightness was excellent, that stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. The image had a head of fine gold, breast and arms of silver, his belly and thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet of part iron and part clay, as we read about it in the book of Daniel, chapter 2, verses 31 through verses 33. Daniel gives him the interpretation of the dream, and this interpretation is to humble Daniel, I humble Nebuchadnezzar, because Daniel is God's man. Thou, O king, art king of kings, for the God of heaven has given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. The kingdom of Babylon was one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. It was a beautiful place. The hanging gardens of Babylon were beautiful. There was no equal and never was to be an equal in their power or in their abilities or in their wealth. There was never to be an equal to them in their majesty of Babylon. These inferior kingdoms, the one thing that they could brag about was their duration. Now, Babylon was a great kingdom, but it only lasted about 70 years. The Medo-Persian kingdom lasted about 200 years. The Greek kingdom lasted about 130 years. The Iron Kingdom, Rome, is the one that lasted and conquered the world and spread over the globe and had power for 500 years. In spite of their military power, their scientific knowledge, each of these kingdoms terminated. Each of them were dismantled, because God wanted them to understand, as Daniel talked to Nebuchadnezzar, that only God can set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. So what the prophet saw on that day was an eternal kingdom, an eternal reign of a monarch that whose kingdom would never be destroyed and would never be torn down. God therefore used this occasion, the occasion of Nebuchadnezzar's dream. He used this occasion for Daniel to reveal that which had been determined even before the foundation of the world, and that is the eternal reign of the kingdom of God, the fact that God in heaven shall set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. So when we think about this, brothers and sisters, what God is saying is, I'm going to set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. It shall stand forever. And you know, mankind builds and rebuilds kingdoms. They talk about Putin on the news the other day, and the fact that he's trying to rebuild the Russian kingdom of the Cold War. That's because the Russian kingdom that used to stand against America in the Cold War was dismantled. Ronald Reagan began that dismantling, and their superpower status was soon gone as their kingdom was torn down and dismantled. So understand something. Only God can set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. The Lord, according to Isaiah chapter 60 and verses 12, the word from the psalmist also says, the Lord is king forever. As David wrote in Psalms 10 and 16, the heathens perish in his land. We know and understand that the Bible clearly tells us, brothers and sisters, that only God can build a kingdom that can never be destroyed. Jesus had a forerunner, and Jesus is to be that king. Jesus is to be the Lord of lords. He is to be the King of kings, and he is to establish that kingdom which will never be destroyed. In the days of the Roman kingdoms, the Bible tells us that John began to announce, the forerunner of John began to announce that the Lord Jesus would come and build a kingdom that shall never be destroyed. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3, beginning at verses 1 and continuing through verses 2, in those days came John the Baptist, preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. John says the kingdom that Daniel talked about, the kingdom that is written about in the book of Isaiah, the kingdom that was prophesied by all the prophets, this kingdom is at hand, and Jesus shall be Lord of lords, and he shall be King of kings. We need to realize something, brothers. The devil has been trying to tear this kingdom down since the very beginning. The devil has always sought to stop God from saving us. The devil hates you. The devil can't stand you because you've got something that he can never have again, and that is the mercy and the love and the kindness and the forbearance and the long-suffering of God. God decided to save us in spite of ourselves. God decided to save us. So Jesus said one time in John chapter 18 and verses 36, Jesus said, as man is attempting to take his life, and wanting him to believe that from their kingdom there is authority to save his life, Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom, the Lord said, not from hence. When Jesus was brought before Pontius Pilate and tried on in that kangaroo court, while you got a bunch of folks lying and doing everything they can to string that poor boy up and take his life for only doing those things that God sent him to do. The scriptures clearly tell us that though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered. Jesus is my example of how to conduct myself as a man in the face of temptations and trials and tribulations. When others run and when others cowered before mankind and his power from his kingdoms, Jesus stood up and looked them in the eye and said, my kingdom is not of this world, because Jesus came to build that everlasting kingdom. They tried my Lord. They stripped my Lord. They gave him 39 stripes on the scourging post. Every one of those stripes that they put on his back, as this big Roman soldier hit him as hard as he could with all of his strength, is to make him renounce that there is a kingdom, to make him renounce that he's the Son of God, to make him renounce that God's going to set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. But the Bible tells me about my Lord, and what gives me strength, No matter what I'm going through in life, the Bible tells me very clearly that he opened not his mouth. When we read about this, this is not saying that Jesus didn't say anything. This is not simply saying that Jesus didn't go into some type of oration. What it is saying is that Jesus took my beating. Jesus took my scourging. And he held his tongue with the power of the universe in his hand. When all he had to do was say the word and 1,000 angels would have come and destroyed everybody, he opened not his mouth. When he could have simply said to the Father, I cannot take this anymore. I cannot endure this anymore. I have done so much for them, and look at how they're treating me. But the Bible says he opened not his mouth. Jesus didn't give up on me, and I cannot give up on him. We've got to stand because Jesus stood for us so that he could bring into existence that kingdom which shall never be destroyed. How many of us, brothers and sisters, fail to understand the love and the grace and the kindness of God in bringing this into existence? Paul said one time to the brethren in Titus chapter 2, verses 11 and verses 12, Paul said, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. What are you saying, Paul? God set this kingdom up by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, who took my beating, who took my scourging, who took my punishment, who stood there in tears and sweat and blood as they beat him half to death, so that he could build this kingdom for my salvation. For this reason, the Apostle Paul said to the brethren in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and verses 2, Paul said, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable unto God, which Paul said is your reasonable service. And then Paul warned us, be not conformed to this world, but you be transformed by the renewing of your mind. What are you saying, Paul? Paul is saying, because he stood, because he suffered, because he bore it, because he wouldn't quit, because he learned obedience, because he stood there and took those nails that this kingdom might come into fruition, as Peter and the other apostles said on the day of Pentecost, it therefore stands, and Satan is doing everything he can to destroy this kingdom, but it still stands. Why does it stand? It stands because God's people stand, because we will not quit on the Lord who did not quit on us. I want you to realize something, that Satan has a plan, and his plan is to create as much conflict, to create as many problems as possible, so that as many of us as possible will contradict those things that are written, and that we from the inside will allow the devil to destroy the Lord's church from the inside. Khrushchev stood up one time and he looked at a young President Kennedy, and he let him know his plans. He said his plans was to take America without firing a shot. He says, I'm going to make your black people fight your white people. Your poor people fight your rich people. Your educated people fight those who are illiterate. I'm going to have those in the South fighting those in the North, and those in the East fighting those that are in the West. And that says, we're going to take your nation, and we're going to do it without firing a shot, because you're going to be divided from the inside. The Lord said one time that a house divided against itself, didn't he say it, cannot stand. And don't you understand that the devil is trying right now to destroy the church from within? He's trying to destroy the kingdom from within by making us those who are the conduits of those things that destroy the church and tear down God's people. The Apostle Paul said one time about the devil's plans in 2 Timothy chapter chapter is 4 and the verse is 3. He said, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust. He says, because there are those who will have their lust, their desires, and their agendas. Because there were those who will love themselves more than they will love the church. Because there are those who will love what they want and what they want to achieve more than taking care of those things which have been commanded us by our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul said, after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears and having desires to hear those things that they want. Now what Paul lets us know is the devil will have a certain degree of success. He's going to make some of us quit, some of us fall. He's going to make some of us so liberal that we don't look like the church anymore. He's going to make some of us stop showing the difference between the holy and the profane, between darkness and between light, between those things that are true and those things that are false. You got to have some people who want this stuff. If you got a false prophecy, you got to have a false prophet. If you got a false teaching, you got to have a false teacher. And what we see around us are those who are gradually falling down the moral and spiritual elevator, who are accepting those things that are not biblical and who are following those things that are not scriptural. So the Apostle Paul went on to say in verses 2, they shall turn away their ears from the truth, shall be turned unto fables. In essence, they're going to listen to legends and myths and the irrelevant and not those things that are true. Now, I want you to get something that I said at Coleman this morning, and I want you to hear this, and I want you to accept this, internalize this, and understand that the kingdom is still standing. The kingdom will keep on standing in spite of the devil's best efforts. In 1 Timothy, the chapter is 4, and the verse is 1. The Apostle Paul speaking to Timothy, he said, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing doctrines and the seducing spirits and the doctrines of devils. Now I want you to notice what the Apostle Paul is saying. Paul is saying some are going to stop listening. Some are going to get to the point to where they will fail to accept gospel preaching. They're not going to want to hear people preach the truth anymore. They're not going to want to stand and sit and have someone tell them what is right anymore. In essence, they're going to turn away from what is true. Now turn with me, if you will, to 2 Timothy, the chapter is 3. And I want you to notice verses 1. The kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God is still standing, and it will continue to stand. But we've got to have courage. We've got to have the ability to fight our fight and to make our stand. Because the devil's going to bring the fight to us. He wants your children. He wants to destroy your marriages. He wants to destroy us as a nation. He wants to turn the church in the eye and perception of the people into just a mindless cult of people who have lost themselves in the past and who are on the wrong side of history. Well, the problem is he knows that if he's going to destroy the church, he's got to do it from the inside. So therefore, the scriptures tell us in 2 Timothy, the chapter is 3, and the verse is 1. Paul said, this know also, that in the last days perilous times, dangerous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful and unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers. They're going to hate those who are good. And he goes on to say, "Treddy, heady, high-minded." And when he talks about these individuals, what he is saying is, these will be dangerous times. Here is the problem. Many of us in the Lord's church, when we read this catalog of abomination, when we read about these spiritual corruptions, we attribute them to the outside of the church. We said a dangerous times are on the outside of the church. When the Apostle Paul is writing this through Timothy, to Timothy, for the church, Paul is saying, no, this is what's happening inside the church. Those individuals that Paul is describing, he's not describing them on the outside. He's describing them on the inside. The devil knows that if he's going to tear down the kingdom, his assault must be internal. That's why the Apostle Paul, when he talked to the elders at Ephesus one time, Paul said, of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. The elders of the Lord's church around the brotherhood, the deacons and preachers of the church around the brotherhood, the men who want to keep their families intact around the brotherhood, the men who want to raise their boys properly as men around the brotherhood, the women who want to raise their daughters, the families that want their daughters to be the pearls of great price around the brotherhood. You better open your eyes, you better stand firm, and you better realize that the devil wants to launch church, but he wants to destroy it from the inside. And as the Apostle Paul talks to Timothy, he tells him, here is what you got to realize going to happen to many of our brethren. In verses 5, he said, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, Paul said, from such turn away. I told the folks at home that that word form comes from a Greek term where we get our word mannequin. And a mannequin, when you go to one of these popular stores, Dillard's or Macy's or wherever it is that you shop, you may see a form. It's standing there. It has clothes on. It has that blank stare in space. It may have a hat on or gloves or whatever the season's clothing are. But it has no life because it is a form. It is a mannequin. It is there for one purpose, and that is to show off the outside clothing that are on it. Don't you understand that many of us are becoming like that mannequin? We got a form of godliness. We got a form of Christianity. We got a form of worship. But what we're doing, as he says, you are denying the power thereof, or God's power is not making you right. We want Christianity, but we don't want Christ. We want ceremony, but we don't necessarily want worship. We want presentations, but we don't really want preaching. In other words, many of us are going to go to hell through the church because we will allow the devil to attack us in our minds and make us compromise and step back from those things that are true. For this reason, Peter said to his brethren in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verses 8, Peter said, be sober, be vigilant. Because your adversary, and he called him by name, the devil, as a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. What are you saying, Peter? The devil wants you. He wants your children. He wants your daughters. He wants your sons. He wants to redefine marriage to where it means what he wants it to mean. He wants to redefine manhood so your sons are wearing dresses. He wants to redefine womanhood so that your daughters look like men. He wants to redesign the family so that it has this new normal. What is the devil doing? He is attacking us from the inside. And what we've got to do is have the courage to stand and do what God has commanded for us to do. As Paul talked to the brethren at Thessalonica, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 11, he said, for this cause God shall send them strong delusions that they should believe a lie, that they all might be condemned who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. The devil wants us to have so much pleasure in being what the world wants us to be that we lose our identity. Church, the church cannot have an identity crisis. Church, the church must understand who and whose they are. Church, the devil wants to get in your head and make you start questioning the basic laws of God to the point that you're ready to compromise and capitulate those things that are written from within. The kingdom will stand, but it will stand because we stand. The kingdom will stand, but it will stand because we fight. The kingdom
kingdom will stand, but it will stand because we resist. And the Lord didn't talk a whole lot about the devil, but what he did tell us is the devil is a liar. The devil is a liar. When can you tell he's lying? Anything he says is a lie. He wants you to understand he is a usurper. He is a liar, and he wants to get among us in the church. In the book of John, the chapter is 8, and the verse is 44. The Lord said one time, you are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. The Lord said he was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. Church, we've got to stand today, because the devil wants to destroy the Lord's kingdom by destroying the Lord's people, and he wants each of us to compromise to the point that we stop doing what God has commanded for us to do. But the kingdom will stand. You know why it will stand? It will stand because we stand. The Lord tells us to stand, and he teaches us to stand, and he tells us we will overcome. In 1 John chapter 5 and verses 4, John wrote, whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. I got faith. I've got faith that no matter what the devil does, the church will stand. I've got faith that elders in the Lord's church around the country will stand up in the face of government that's being intrusive into those things that we believe. I've got faith that ministers will stand up and preach the gospel in its purity and simplicity, in season and out of season. I've got faith that families of the Lord in the Lord's church will stand and protect marriage and protect their children and protect everything that we believe. I've got faith that this will happen, because the devil's going to bring the fight to you, and he wants to destroy us from within. The kingdom of God will stand. The kingdom of God will continue to stand. As the Apostle Paul said to the brethren in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 12, Paul said, Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. The devil's going to come with the tricks that is more important to get people in the building than it is to get them to heaven. It is more important to have participation than it is to have obedience. It's more important to make a stand and a show before denominationalism than it is to be obedient to our Lord in heaven. Paul said, be strong and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the tricks and the seductions and the lies of the devil. Why, Paul? He tells us in verses 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. What are you saying, Paul? The wickedness that you fight against is going to be in the high places. It's going to be all the way to the White House. It's going to be in the Congress and in the Senate. It's going to be in a judicial branch where judges legislate from the bench and overturn the democratic vote of the people. It's going to happen that you stand, and you resist. You're not fighting people, but you're fighting the devil's organized attempt to destroy this kingdom. And you've got to stand, and you've got to put on that whole armor so that you can stand, and so that you can resist, and so that you will not quit in the face of the trials and the tribulations that most certainly are going to come. And my brothers and my sisters, on this day, you need to understand that the devil is a murderer. He is a liar, and he's going to pervert religion so that there will be people who will follow the wrong ways rather than standing for that which is right. The Apostle Paul, when he was talking to the brethren in the Galatian region, the Apostle Paul says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. What are you saying, Paul? There are going to be those who are going to pervert the gospel. They're going to change God's will. You know, my grandpa used to say, and I remember this, my daddy also used it in sermons, that, you know, rat poison, back in the day when they put rat poison down on the farm, he said that rat poison was 99% cornmeal. It was 1% strychnine poisoning. It was the 1% that killed you, not the 99%, which was cornmeal. It was the 1% that killed you. What Paul wanted the brethren to know, that when people pervert the gospel, they don't have to make great deviations. They don't have to make great proclamations. They can just do slight and very slick changes that make us alter the way we worship and alter the way we believe, to the point that we are following those things that are perverted and not those things that are right. Brothers and sisters, it's not about whether we agree on an issue. It's about whether or not we are obedient. We can't claim that fellowship is simply cooperation. Fellowship is obedience. We can disagree, but we can't disobey. Every one of us have got to obey, and we've got to give the authority that the Lord demands. He said when he walked from the tomb, all power in heaven and in earth is given unto me. He has all authority. And when the Apostle Paul talked to the brethren in Rome, in Romans chapter 1 and verses 16, Paul said, I'm not ashamed. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. My brothers and my sisters, you need to understand something today. The kingdom of God will continue to stand in spite of what Satan does. The kingdom of God will continue to stand. It will stand and it will preach those things which are true. In spite of everything that man does to tear it down, it will continue to stand. Remember always that our Lord and our Savior gave us the example when the Lord stood and he accepted our beating and our punishment. When the Lord stood and he looked evil in the eye and did not flinch. What the Lord shows me is how I am to stand. He tells me very clearly they hated me before they hated you. The Apostle Paul said, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. These malicious deeds that they shall do, they're going to continue to do them. But the kingdom of God will continue to stand. I want you to realize something tonight, my brothers and my sisters, that many times I have said, and you have said, and we have watched as men attack God's law, God's church, God's people, and God's will. But each of us have still got to stand. We got to stand, not in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God, 1 Corinthians 2 and 5. We've got to stand in the gospel as it was declared and preached to us by the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 15 and 1. We must stand watching and being strong and acting like men, as the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 16 and verses 13. We must stand in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, Galatians chapter 5 and verses 1. We must stand fully clad in the whole armor of God, as the Apostle Paul told the brethren in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11 through 13. We must stand in one spirit and one mind, striving for the faith of the gospel, Philippians chapter 1 and verses 27. We got to stand holding the traditions which we have been taught, whether by word or by epistle, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 15. We must stand, and when we stand, and when we preach, and when we persevere, the kingdom of God will continue to stand, because God's people will be obedient, God's people will be victorious, and God's people will change the world. The Lord sent us to change the world. There are people who are saying the world is going to be destroyed and the country is going to be destroyed. The Lord said this, you are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. It is our responsibility to salt. If your community is rotting, if your school system is rotting, if the church is rotting, maybe there's not enough salt. You've got to put the salt out there that's going to savor and save this country. We can't compromise, we can't capitulate, and we can't quit. As Christians, that's what we've got to do. You've got to hear about the wonderful Savior who gave his life upon the cross, Jesus Christ. He gave his life. He gave his all. If dying for me was the most he could do, living for him is the least I can do. And give my life as a living sacrifice. I've got to hear about this young man born by a virgin named Mary. I've got to hear about this young man at 12 who they said this man grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor of God and man. He grew in wisdom, he grew intellectually, he grew in stature, he grew physically, he grew in favor of God, he grew spiritually, and he grew in favor of man, he grew socially. I've got to hear about this man that chose 12 men and began to preach a new way of thinking, standing on a mountainside with the Sea of Galilee behind him and the natural acoustics as he talked to a multitude, when he taught them how to be happy and he taught them how to be real and how to have faith and how to change their life and how to obey their God. I've got to hear how this young man was hated not because he committed sin, but because he came to build the kingdom and said that I am the Son of God. I am the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I've got to hear how the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians and the high priests and the lawyers and the scribes and the religious big shots and the political big shots looked at him with an eye of evil to tear him down and destroy him before this kingdom could be built and before it could take root so that it could save the world. The devil has got to destroy this boy. He's got to destroy this boy before this kingdom is built. He came when he was half dead. He had not eaten or drank for 40 days. And the devil came. I've got to hear how at his weakest moment that the strongest being of evil came before him. Why don't you turn those stones to bread? Boy, you know you're hungry. Eat you some bread. You don't have anything to prove. Jesus said, man don't live by bread alone. And that's written. Why don't you cast yourself down from here so that the angels, as the scriptures say, can catch you so that you not even hit your feet against the rocks? Jesus says it is written. You don't play with God like that. You don't tempt God. The devil said, look at everything that's out there. Just bow down to me. Just bow down. Just bow down. Look at you. You're half dead. You're emaciated. Your lips are cracked. Your eyes are red. Your body is shaking. If you just bow down to me in your weak moment, now that you're half dead and you put up a good fight, the devil will come to you and say, you put up a good fight. Oh, yeah, you stood well. You did the best you could for your family. You did the best you could for the church. You did the best you could for the world. But don't you think you deserve a little something now? And the devil comes with that perversion of thought of spirituality. And he's going to cause many to substitute church going for Christianity. So you've got to hear about this boy. Because he stood there half dead. And he looked the evil in the eye and said, you should worship God. You worship God. You worship God. And him only do you serve. You need to hear about this young man. You need to hear about how he went around and he did good, how he fed the multitudes. You need to hear about the woman that said, if I can only touch the hem of his garments, I'll be healed. You need to hear about the men that were blind that could see and those who were paralyzed that could walk. As he walked about doing those things, Jesus' mission was twofold. To show man who God was, that God is a God of love. In the golden text of the Bible in John 3, the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might have life. You need to hear about this boy, this young man that God sent. When they took him from judgment hall to judgment hall, They stripped his clothing off. They blindfolded him. They smacked him upside his face and said, "Who hit you?" Somebody spit in his face with his hands tied that he can't even move the spittle that someone has harked and spit in his face that he can't even wipe it away as it goes toward his mouth. They put a crown of thorns on his head with needle sharp thorns piercing his flesh, and the blood runs down his face. You need to hear about this boy that built this kingdom, this young man that stood for you. You need to hear how they put him over the scourging post, and they took a whip with iron balls and all types of broken pieces of iron and metal and rock, and they hit him 39 times on his back. 39 times as he has bent over the scourging post, because the Roman soldiers really don't want to go to Golgotha's hill because it smells up there. They're rotting bodies up there. There are dogs and wolves and buzzards up there. They really want to kill him on the scourging post so they don't have to go and nail him on the cross. But Jesus endured. He's got to get this kingdom built. He's got to finish the job that God gave him. He came to show us who God is, and he came to show us who we are capable of becoming. The Bible says he knew no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Jesus said, "I have overcome the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life." They beat him 39 times. They took him from the scourging post. They put his clothing back on him. They put over 100-pound cross on his shoulders and led him toward a garbage heap on the outside of town. And he's got to maintain his sanity. He's got to keep his eyes open. He cannot go unconscious. He cannot fall down. He cannot quit, because he's got to get this kingdom built. He's got to finish the job that God gave him. He drug that cross, being helped on the other side by someone commissioned to carry the backside of the cross. And they stripped him of his clothing. You need to hear this. And they laid his arms on the cross, and they took nails, and they nailed those nails in his hands. Somebody took a hammer and put their foot on his arm. Somebody else took a rope, and they pulled his arm taut, and they drove that nail through his hands, and they drove that nail through his hands, and they lifted up the cross and bent the nail behind him. You need to hear this, because too many of us in the church, we want the cross, but we don't want the blood. We want the salvation, but we don't want the suffering. We want the blessings, but we don't want the responsibilities. And we're trying to build churches now that take the cross and the suffering and the blood, and Satan wants to destroy this kingdom from the inside by doing this. They put a rope on the other hand. They put their foot on that cross. They pulled his hand taut, and they put that nail on his hand, and they drove that nail through his hand, and they drove that nail through his hand, and they lifted him up again, and they nailed the nail and bent the nail behind his hand. Can you see his face? Can you see the agony? Can you see the pain? Can you see the suffering? Can you see the blood? Can you see your Savior, who God sent to build this everlasting kingdom, this kingdom which shall never be destroyed? But the price of that kingdom, the price of that salvation, the price of that reconciliation, the price of that atonement, the price of that revival, the price of that restoration is the blood of Jesus Christ, my substitute, my propitiation, who has to give his life so that I can be saved. They bent his body crooked, and they laid it on the platform before they put his feet out, and they bent his body crooked, and they nailed that nail through his feet, and they nailed that nail through his feet, and they lifted up the cross, and they bent the nail. Then they lifted him up with ropes and pulleys. As the Lord, I can see his face, as his hands are back and forth, as he clenches his fist, and he clenches his teeth, and he uses every bit of power and ability that he has to stay conscious, because he's got to finish this job. He's got to build this kingdom. And they raised that middle cross with a thief on the right and a thief on the left, and Jesus in the middle with his body crooked, because they crucified them that way, because they had to push up so they could take a breath, and they would sink back down, and they had to push up so they could take a breath, and they would sink back down. And when they got tired of hearing their agony and tired of hearing their cries and tired of hearing them call out, they would break their legs so they couldn't rise up anymore. And my Savior, you need to hear about this, is on that cross. It's Jesus on that cross. It's Jesus, the Son of God, on that cross. It's the one who came for my sins on that cross. It's the one who came to build the kingdom on that cross. It's my perpetuation on that cross, my substitute on that cross. He told one man, this night you're going to be with me in paradise. He prayed to his Father, my God, why have you forsaken me? He looked at his killers and his murderers and said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. But then he uttered some words that are the most powerful, the most benevolent, the most providential words that have ever been spoken, when he said, it is finished. 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 And my Lord and your Lord, he didn't die like everybody else. The Bible said he lowered his head and he gave up the ghost. He told Pontius Pilate, you don't take my life from me. I give my life. And at the proper time, he gave his life. He lowered his head, and he gave up the ghost. He gave it up. The ghost leaves us. The Bible lets us know that our body returns to the dust from which it came, and the spirit to God from which it came. So we take that breath, and our head falls. But Jesus, he determined the moment of his death. He bowed his head, and he gave up the ghost. Why? Because this young man has paid the price of my salvation. I need to hear that. I need to hear that, and I need to believe that. I need to believe that with all of my heart. The Bible tells me in Romans 10 that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I've got to hear that, and I've got to believe that. And we got to stop being sterile and dead inside. We got to stop replacing worship for ceremony, church going for Christianity. The devil wants to destroy this kingdom from within. The government can't kill us and will not. Perverted doctrine will not destroy us. The kingdom is fortified. It will stand forever. All the devil can do is destroy us, individuals, and make us renounce those things that are right. You got to believe it. And you got to make a decision that I'm going to be a subject in the kingdom. Jesus will be my king. Jesus will be my Lord. I renounce my stubborn will. I renounce my arrogance and my disobedience. I'm going to stop being one who fights the Lord when he's trying to help me. Why are we fighting the one person who gave us everything? I'm going to repent of my sins, and I'm going to acknowledge his lordship, that he's the King of Kings, he's the Lord of Lords, and that he is the king in the kingdom. Now I'm going to bury my old man, as the Apostle Paul said, mortify this body, this man, mortify him, put him to death. Anything dead needs burying. Bury him in a watery grave. Leave him in that watery grave. And the word resurrection means to rise again. You stand up again. You stand up and you walk in the newness of life. If for some reason you lose sight of the kingdom and the fact that you have a king, his name is Jesus, and you forget who you are and whose you are, and you start looking at the world and it begins to attract you, and even though God said, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world begins to pull you away. Repent. 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 Have a moment. Be for real. Bow your head. Get before your God in godly sorrow. So I can't believe I sinned when Jesus did so much for me. And he set this kingdom up and gave his life for me. I can't believe, Father, I did that. Can't believe I said that. I can't believe I did it. Will you please forgive me? God says, yes, I forgive you. When you approach me like my child in godly sorrow, when you have repented and examined yourself and you don't like what you see and you want me to strengthen you and help you, yes, yes, I forgive you. The kingdom will stand. Will you stand?
The kingdom will be strong. Will you be strong? The kingdom will have influence in the affairs of men. Will you have influence? Think about it. Are we stand.
Science calls me the rings over land and sea.
Comments will be brief, but it strikes me that over the last 48 hours, we've had millions of Americans spend 2.5 hours of their time in a movie theater watching a Hollywood blockbuster that doesn't come close to touching the power of the story of Noah, the power of God's Word. You've spent half the time. I wish I could get those millions who've spent 2.5 hours watching that listening to this message tonight. What a difference that would make. Brother DeBerry, we love you. I'm not just saying this to say it. I'm not just heaping on praise. But if we stopped this lectureship right now, it would be worth every hour invested, every mile driven, every moment spent. And we appreciate very much the good sermons that we've heard today. And thank you, Brother DeBerry, for standing in this kingdom of ours, in this kingdom of God alongside of us. Another stalwart soldier of the cross is Brother Garland Nelkins, and he has written this booklet on the whole truth about homosexuality, and we need to stand for this truth. And after a sermon like that, is there anyone here motivated to fight the good fight of faith? Indeed. These booklets are available at Brother Elkins's table over in the display area. They're free, and they are intended to be distributed, and as Brother Elkins characteristically does, as he did 30 years ago in 1984 when he was on the Donahue Show, he presents the truth. He does it scripturally, but he does it in a very loving way. And these materials are available over there in the display area. He has sent these to all of the legislators in this state. I know that's been sent to the President of the United States, and it's been sent to a number of people in influential high places, such as were mentioned by Brother DeBerry tonight. This is the word that we need to get out, so please get that word out. The book, Still Standing But Not Standing Still, is going to be available in just a few minutes after we dismiss for about 30 minutes in the book display area over in the fellowship hall area. And we'd love for you to get a copy of it. Lectures such as this one and many others will be available in print form. I want to tell you that if you'd like to watch the sermon again, or if you know someone you'd like to tell about, about this sermon to, if you'd like to talk to them about this sermon, then if you direct them to our website at msop.org, the www.msop.org, this sermon is there, and all of the sermons that are preached this week will be available both on oabs.org and through msop.org. And we've got some new ways of streaming that content this year so that if you have trouble with your device in one platform, you'll be able to receive it in the other platform. So please keep that in mind. Yes. Okay. The tickets for the dinner for Brother Cates tomorrow night at 4:15, those will be available actually in this building. Sister Brown's going to be in the school building office over here. And so if you'd like to get those tickets for that dinner tomorrow, then you can see her if you'd like to buy the books or be involved in looking at the display area over there for 30 minutes. It will be available. One other thing, Matt Jones tells me that all of the young people are invited to the fellowship area also for the regular Sunday night with Matt and Nancy that they have with the four still young people and the other young people who are visiting here this week. You're certainly invited to be a part of that after services tonight. All right, is there anything else that needs to be announced besides the fact that we have only just begun a great day in store for us tomorrow? Our students speak in chapel every morning, and that's a very encouraging time at 8:30, and we'd love for you to hear our students present the Word of God. And then tomorrow we'll be hearing about great men of faith like Micaiah of the Old Testament who stood. We'll hear about standing against denominationalism. The ladies will have great messages from women like Celicia Greider and Jenny Knox and others. We'll be speaking throughout the week. We have some powerhouse preachers in store for you as well tomorrow. Great subjects. And because of the hour, I won't read them to you. You can read the schedules are out on the table in the lobby as you leave. And we'd be certainly thrilled for you to pick up a copy and come back and be with us. All right, you have a closing song. Brother Joe Kaysen is with us, one of the elders from the Collierville congregation, where Brother Tory Clark, one of our graduates, is now the gospel preacher there. And Brother Kaysen, glad to have you with us. Looking forward to the prayer, the song before it. And I'm fired up. What about you? Let's go, let's go, let's go.
Just a moment of personal privilege. I had the opportunity to go to the Capitol several times a year, and in March 2011, an atheist came to the House Education Committee on which Brother DeBerry sits, and she came kind of slinging around some nonsense in that committee. And the same man that you saw tonight in the pulpit was the same man I saw in the Education Committee that day. I'm thankful for him. Appreciate the sermon that he delivered to us tonight. Let's stand together. 5:23.
There is.
Bow with me, please. Dear God, our Holy Father in heaven, we humbly come before your throne, thanking thee, dear God, for your love for us, for your precious Son coming to this earth and suffering and dying upon the cross of Calvary, shedding his blood that we might have that hope of salvation. Father, we are grateful for the speaker of the hour. We're so thankful for the message that he's brought to us, that we might benefit by being uplifted by your word, that might help us to motivate to stand up for thee, to live our lives in such a way that others might see Jesus living within us. Help us, dear God, to be an influence in this world for good and to reach out to those that are lost and dying in sin. Father, we're grateful for the elders of this congregation and for the leadership they give to her. We're thankful for the school of preaching and for the faculty that work so diligently in teaching those about your word. Father, we pray that you be with every member that's here this evening. We're so grateful for all that has been able to be here, that each of us might leave this place with a greater determination to stand up for thee and let others see Jesus and know that we are your children and that we're living our lives for thee. Bless each and every one. Give us all a safe trip home, and we pray that we each might be able to come back tomorrow for those that will be preaching and teaching your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.